Well, it's been 6 years since the start of the political rift that sparked Libya's second civil war. Now, UN officials say they are one step closer to unifying the country's bitterly opposed factions. Peace talks are currently underway in Geneva to appoint a temporary Libyan government to oversee national elections come December. On Tuesday, a group of 75 participants cast their votes for a three-person presidency council, but there were no clear winners. So the talks will go on as candidates from the council work together to elect a temporary prime minister. Well, my next guest is mediating these crucial peace talks. Stephanie Williams is the UN Secretary General's acting special representative for Libya, and she says the country is counting on the mission to bring an end to years of violence in the war-torn country. She joins me now live from Geneva, and it's good to have you on, and it's important to have you on at this point. To your mind, what is the current status of talks?
Well, I'm very encouraged by what I've seen here in Geneva this week. As you mentioned, we had the first vote for the Presidency Council. None of the candidates met the threshold designated in the Electoral College. So now we're going to a list formation for a vote that would include three members of the Presidency Council and the Prime Minister position. And those lists, we expect there will be no more than four lists, are due to be submitted to the mission tonight at 10 p.m. our time. For a vote expected tomorrow.
The system proposed to reach elections in December, I have to say, is quite a complex system. Why and how has this process been established this way, just out of interest?
Okay, so there are two things. One is Libyans want elections, and that was accomplished in Tunis in mid-November when this group first met, set the elections date for December 24th of this year, which coincides with Libya's Independence Day. National elections are taking place. That's a sacred goal, and that's what we're working towards. The other piece of it, of course, is that you've had these bitter divisions, you know, particularly for the last 6-7 years. Libyans want their institutions to be united, and this will actually help move the country towards elections to set, you know, the security, stabilize the security situation, to improve living conditions, to ensure that services are reaching municipalities.
Okay. So this is the political sort of sphere, and let's be positive here. These are positive political developments, and we applaud you and your team and those who are on the ground there for the progress that has been made. And the negotiations, of course, have been led by yourself. Military factions on the ground, though, as per a CNN report last month, reveal the continuing presence of foreign fighters and indeed mercenaries who were required to leave last month per an agreement between the warring parties. How large is that current presence of foreign fighters? Why haven't they left? And who's responsible at this point?
So in terms of the size, the numbers, I've put them at around 20,000, you know, occupying either fully or partially about, you know, 10 bases on Libyan soil. Look, the 5+5, the Joint Military Commission, is actually meeting again today in Sirte. It's their seventh round. They are going to really move forward, I expect, on the implementation of the opening of the coastal road between Abu Grain and Sirte. And this is, you know, to enable the free flow of people and goods between eastern and western Libya. It's a challenge, but the simple message is the Libyans have spoken. Yep. Listen to the Libyans. They've made it very clear. They set a 90-day clock. It was ambitious. That doesn't make it any less of a legitimate, you know, Libyan request or any less binding, frankly, on the countries or organizations that have brought these mercenaries to Libya.
Because these foreign fighters and mercenaries on the ground, and if you put them their numbers at, say, 20,000, are still there and are, haven't left as prescribed by these negotiations before Christmas, suggests, certainly their continued presence suggests, that there is no real impetus on the ground to reach a conclusion to all of this. Is that your concern?
Look, I'm listening to the Libyans, and it's very clear from what we see in the three Libyan tracks that we have been running that Libyans want to restore their decision-making. They want to restore their sovereignty. They want to restore the democratic legitimacy of their institutions. And so it's basically, it's now incumbent upon the international community to respect the desire of the Libyans and to, frankly, abide by, these countries' own obligations, both with regard to the UN arms embargo and the commitments that they signed up to at the Berlin conference last year on the 19th of January, 2020.
Stephanie, this all against the backdrop of COVID, of course. What support are you getting from the international community, especially with regard vaccines, in Libya's own battle against this virus?
Yes, well, this is, of course, the conflict, institutional division, and the severe deterioration of infrastructure, particularly health infrastructure, not to mention the fact that many clinics were bombed during the war on Tripoli last year, has put a huge strain on Libyan capacity to combat COVID. Certainly, the UN is on the ground. The World Health Organization has been very active across the country in helping the Libyans, the authorities, to address the situation. We have over 113,000 cases, and something like 1,800 deaths so far. So yes, they do need assistance. The international community is providing assistance.
Stephanie, as we've said, you have 4 days left in this current role, with Jan Kubis named special envoy on Libya last month. As you hand over the file, and you are smiling at this point, I'm sure you are exhausted by it, but do you hand this file over with a genuine sense that there is resolution in the near term?
I am encouraged by what I've seen here. Look, this is not without its challenges. We've made enormous progress. There have been important steps forward. The Libyans are talking to each other. 75 Libyans who are here, Libyans in the other tracks. We've done something that's quite unprecedented. We've had 43 candidates put themselves forward for the presidency and prime minister positions, and we've aired their presentations live on Libyan television, and they have been, subjected to a pretty rigorous question and answer, session. There's a lot of transparency here. Libyans like it. Libyans have now very high expectations, and frankly, they want these institutions to unite. They want to return the country to a degree of normalcy. So I'm encouraged. I think the United Nations is on the ground. Mr. Kubis is here with me in Geneva. We're doing our transition as we speak, and I'm very, very confident moving forward.
I wonder, as you look back at your time in this role, whether you are satisfied with what you have accomplished. And I do also wonder whether you wish that Washington had perhaps taken more interest in the Libya file under a Trump administration. And further to that, how you think a Biden administration will deal with this file. Is Washington better involved or not, as it were?
Well, I think it's always very helpful when the international community comes in squarely behind the United Nations. Look, I came to Libya to work with the Libyans, and I leave with them in mind. The international community is very important. Certainly, a strong and positive U.S. role is key, and I believe that will be the case moving forward.